Okay, welcome to this event. I'm very happy to host you today, José, inside our festivities of the 50th years of the Getia. Today we are going to speak, I think, about quite a crucial subject. What is the role of architecture and architecture theory in relation to the building practice? And that's a test you try to do in this book by asking different scholars to write on it, but I'm not going to speak too much because I will be part of the discussion and I won't tell you what I'm going to say afterwards. So, José, please take over and welcome here.
Well, thank you. Everybody can hear me without a mic, right?
Yes.
Thank you, Laurent, for the nice introduction. Thank you, Getia, for hosting this event. Delighted to be here in Zurich. I'm going to talk a little bit about the project, but I'm going to shorten the presentation quite a bit. Actually, it takes about 30 to 35 minutes really to go through everything. I'm trying to make it in around 15 minutes, if possible, or 20 minutes. Basically, you see now as a book, but the project has four phases. Started with two symposia organized in 2014, one at the AA, second one at Columbia University. Continued in the form of a theory seminar at Cornell in 2015. Then the actual production of the book, which came out at the end of last year, November 2016. And then what has become basically a fourth phase for the project, which is a number of events, panel discussions, lectures around the US in spring and then around Europe in the fall, to kind of keep fostering the conversation around the agenda, but more importantly, to kind of test how the outcome resonates differently with different audiences in different geographies. Right? Project started with a very simple diagnosis, really. Years ago, I was the first, second year PhD student at Princeton, and as I was becoming more and more fascinated by the kind of intellectual expansion that I was being exposed to, at the same time, it became apparent to me that there wasn't a lot of discussion on architectural design within scholarly circles in architecture. So in other words, that there wasn't a lot of architecture in architecture. So I shared that with a number of colleagues, faculty, friends. Everybody seemed to agree, so there was a kind of repressed quality to the issue. Right? Let's bring it to the surface. Let's gather historians, theorists, PhD candidates, and architects around that which is supposed to bring everybody together or establish a common ground for everyone, i.e. architectural thinking as a form of knowledge. So well, here's what I'm going to kind of skip over this very fast, but basically I put in some pictures of the two events. This is the one at the AA, June 2014, pretty much everybody was here. I mean, I'm sure you guys know most of the faces, kind of British style, polemical, not very politically correct. The one at Columbia, more conference style, more politically correct, but interesting in a different way. Seeing Rick Walker, Stan Allen, Shumi in the audience, Leon Ockman, Sylvia Levin, Alejandro Zarapolo, and so on. And then a number of pictures of the events we've done after publication of the event. You see, it has André Tavares, the first one at the Lisbon Architectural Triennale, this is for Lars in New York, this at MIT. See Michael Hayes, Alan McJackie, Rafael Siegels at Columbia, Bernard, Amal, Stan, UIC, Chicago, see Bob Sommel, John McMorrow, Penelope Dean, Sean Keller, in LA, Sylvia Levin, Neil Denary, Mark Lee, lecture at Columbia during the summer series, and then the first here in Europe, Pefele about a month ago, with Kirsten, Christoph, it's in Madrid last week, see Stan, Emilio Tuñón, and the Galeano, beginning to work on a graphic representation and all of this to kind of have a better assessment of the scope and the impact of the project internationally. matrix with the participants and contributors. Basically, the idea was to convene many, if not most, of the top thinkers in our field internationally, while at the same time appealing to both history, theory, and practices of the present ages as of late August, so we're doing the thing pretty well, about 40, 60 more or less. How the building gets represented across different posters is just a sample of the spring, last spring. Alright, so usually what I do is I share a number of propositions that underpin the theoretical armature around the project. I don't elaborate on any of them, I just articulate them briefly, but I'm going to make it even shorter, so I'm just going to basically read it, you know, what you see on the slides. First, building is a necessary condition for contribution to knowledge in architecture. Without any elaboration, this sounds a bit controversial. Hopefully, we'll be able to clarify it a little bit more during the discussion. Second, interdisciplinary processes are rooted in difference, so usually we tend to emphasize the opposite, yeah? The zones of overlap and intersections. Here, the claim is that first and foremost, we have to account for the differences between the different fields, either within design or beyond design. Third, as a result of the so-called theoretical turn of the late 1960s, architectural history theory began to import concepts and terms and theoretical frameworks from fields outside of architecture, and that became a pattern that remains dominant to this day. Another dynamic in parallel, the discussion of the building as something else, the building as the reification of power structure, the building as the locus of emotional content, the building as a catalyst for the psychology of perception, the building as the building as the building as. So here the idea is to kind of not overturn, that wouldn't make sense, and actually those two dynamics have a lot of good things about them and they're necessary, but to kind of balance out if possible by defining a twofold agenda for the project. So on the one hand, to discuss, this is important, that's why I'm kind of articulating it further, to discuss what it means for a building to embody a historically significant contribution in terms of a design aspect, a design move, or a building element, yeah? Or a concept relevant to the building of buildings in general, that would be to go from the building as to the building as a realm of research in its own right. And then second, more ambitiously, to kind of see whether there are ways in which buildings can engender concepts, terms, and even theoretical frameworks whose impact could actually exceed the discipline of architecture. So for architecture's tendency to import, to coexist with its capacity to export. This is one of the ones that I think resonates very differently in a European context relative to an American context. When I say here, a building is not only form, everybody would say, well, that's kind of obvious to me, right? In an American context, this is a little bit different, so I emphasize a building is not only form. At the very least, it's a combination of form and program. Let's leave it at that. Discursive and representational knowledge and architecture are two different things, right? Discursive knowledge proceeds through narratives, premises, conclusions, terms, concepts as channeled through thought and expressed through language. Representational knowledge, typical of design practices and related fields, proceeds through images, drawings, models, and so on, is characteristic of architecture. This distinction is particularly important when it comes to architectural knowledge in a discursive sense. Therefore, architectural thinking is something like the practice of producing discursive knowledge out of the analysis, conceptualization, and discussion of aspects pertaining to two inextricably linked domains, yeah? The domain of the building on the one hand, and then the domain of the design process leading to the building on the other hand, which we might call as a subset of architectural thinking in terms of design thinking. Therefore, architectural thinking is a distinct domain of discursive knowledge, yeah? Distinct domain of discursive knowledge, which attributes which will be informal aesthetics. Again, this in a European context is more or less obvious. Not so much in an American context. Of course, we're not going to elaborate on the philosophical aspects of that. Specificity and autonomy are two different things, right? For reasons we don't have time to discuss here, architectural thinking is not autonomous in principle for at least three reasons. However, it is a specific domain of knowledge. Right? And to put it in very short, autonomy is grounded in specificity, to be sure, but specificity does not imply autonomy. So basically, this is like the core of the project, yeah, capitalizing on a combination of specificity and non-autonomy. The aim here is to produce a kind of knowledge that is at once architecturally specific and at the same time generalizable. Yeah. So rooted in the specificity of architectural thinking, at the same time applicable outside the boundaries of the discipline. Yeah. Well, just a few words about the structure of the book itself. Six labels under which 30 case studies are categorized. These labels are deliberately chosen so that they are directly relevant to architecture and they're at the same time elemental enough that they can also serve as heuristic devices to access fields of knowledge outside of architecture. Then second section, critical essays on the building, larger essays. The other first ones are very short, addressing case studies, individual building, chosen by the authors themselves, through which they could tackle the twofold agenda that I suggested. And the only condition is that they have to be built or designed, not necessarily built only, could be unbuilt, within the last 25 years. Second one, longer essays. Addressing this question of architectural thinking as a form of knowledge, partly through reflections on the rest of materials in the book, yeah, so that the conversation keeps going actually across the book pages, not only like in a kind of frozen type of knowledge. Of course, there are no transcriptions in the book either. And then a section on what it would mean this renewed interest in the building in the context of today's architectural education, either nationally or at least in the West. And I'm tempted to leave it at that, because basically the second section, what I do is I share five examples from the book which speak to the first part of the agenda. So buildings that embody a historically significant contribution in terms of a design aspect, a building element, or a concept relevant to the building of buildings in general. But since we're kind of running a little bit short of time, I'm just going to go through the slides, and I usually speak a little bit about Fujimoto's Any House, and some of the studios' travel hands in terms of the construction process, MBODB's Expo 2000 Dutch Pavilion in relation to the so-called 1909 theorem, as identified by Kohas in the Leaders of New York, to talk about the skyscraper's embodiment of the stacking of independent plots within the single envelope. Talk about Antonio Cortés, essay on Sendai Militech in relation to the Maison Domino. Yeah? So basically the idea is that you can place these buildings within a particular historical lineage in order to be able to illustrate the way in which these add something to that lineage, right? The way in which these actually embody something really new, right? Supposed to rhetorically new. And lastly, interestingly, the managerial thresholds here at San Francisco Center by Matt Fauchot from this very school. And then five examples. Of course, the second part of the agenda is very ambitious. I did know that nobody was going to kind of fulfill it entirely, but you do see hints of it in some of the examples here, where authors managed to identify something in the reading of these buildings which resonate with disciplines outside of architecture. So I talk a little bit about this statement, in particular by Stan on Massi Antonio's Moussac, which is general enough to affect design of architecture, how an organizational model actually could be read in terms of basically an epistemological model, basically, so a way of understanding reality outside of the building in which that model was born. Idea of sameness in relation to photography, art history, or metaphysics, for example, in terms of the problem between identity and difference. Architectural iconolatry, as suggested by Bukia, and as opposed to architectural iconicity, which would be a little bit different. So how certain buildings embody a kind of unstable identity, and yet they are still iconic. Yeah, that's not the usual way we think of iconicity, which is more about a kind of stable identity because of the profile of the building. Think of the Birkin in opposition to this one. And this one is no slide, because Andrew Benjamin is a philosopher who speaks about basically the two sets of networks that you can sort of read a building in relation to, so an external one that perceives the building, and then the internal one materialized within the building itself. And it's purely disciplinary how you can actually think the two sets of networks in relation to each other to kind of reconceptualize the outside of the building. And I end with a list of some 60 concepts pertaining specifically to architectural thinking, just to make the argument that if you zoom in deep enough, it turns out that architectural thinking is a rather sophisticated domain of thinking, has nothing to do, or at least the expression spatial thinking falls a lot short relative to what's going on here. And furthermore, you can envision easily, or quote unquote easily, pick out two or three terms here, study the relationships between them, and then out of that study, kind of create a theoretical framework, even more ambitiously, a system of thought that could potentially meaningfully alter fields of knowledge outside of architecture. So it is this idea of growing transforming architecture's discursive capacities from within and then ignite its potential to expand its limits and audiences that we see as the engine to bridge the domain of history theory criticism on the one hand and practice studio culture on the other hand. So hopefully, if not entirely, hopefully we accomplished some of that. And that's it. Thank you.
Just a few very dutifully wrote down some observations with a book reviewer's glee. I was looking forward to receiving the book, and I was curious about two things. Firstly, the methodology that you would use for the selection and the treatment of the works, the buildings. And secondly, I was curious to see whether there would be an ideological message arising from this criteria and also from the way that the buildings are interpreted. So the first observation to make was that actually the criteria for selection was transferred very neatly to the authors. So one of the questions that perhaps we could address is the criteria for the selection of the authors. Buildings. Then the nature of the buildings that were selected, many of them are not built. All of them are all of them are experimental, highly experimental. So examples of unbuilt buildings, Rafi Segal's unbuilt National Library of Israel, and I'm sure that you would take issue with that. As well, the charming Truffle House, very, very experimental. I loved the essay on the generic suburban American house with these Piranesian plans that you were very kind to show that looked anything but generic, so that's very provocative. And of course, the filmic presence of buildings, the building that only exists in Stanley Kubrick's imagination and put onto film, the Overlook Hotel from The Shining. In terms of ideology, your agenda is twofold. Like you described, this idea that, first of all, the way in which buildings embodied a theoretical aspect or an element of a theoretical discourse, and secondly, the mechanisms and characteristics that allow buildings to generate their own theoretical. Ultimately, what you're addressing is a divide between theory and practice, which is a situation that arose in particular in US schools of architecture in the 70s and 80s. This is something that Alan Cochran talks a bit about, having been a practitioner who moved to America and forced into the position of professor of history and theory of architecture. And it's a consequence of a move to integrate architecture into the university structure, with the consequences, and I sort of quote loosely from Cocoon, the identification of history and theory with humanities, the separation of undergraduate, i.e. professional, and graduate, i.e. academic degrees, and even the separation of theory itself according to the different agendas of the various departments. And as Stephen Phillips says in your book, to bridge the gap, it's necessary to educate theorists about practice and practitioners about theory. You use a very nice word, zeitgeisty, to describe this rapprochement of your agenda to that Kurhaas effected with his return to the fundamentals of architecture in the Biennale in 2014. And then Philip argued in his essay that whereas Ulhas's attitude was ultimately quite regressive, what you attempt is something quite different because it's forward-looking. You, Philip, were uneasy with the didactic element that deconstructed architectural discipline into particles in Ulhas's Biennale, and also that was also an element that led to its popularity. Whereas the book, The Building, cannot be said to make the same mistake. It is paradoxically, as far as I'm concerned, a book about theory. It is written about theorists, mostly, and it is addressed to theorists. It is at a level that many practitioners would struggle to engage with, certainly in Europe, I'd say. I enormously enjoyed the critical essays that have this feeling of a hall of mirrors, you know, because there are essays about the book, The Building, in the same book, The Building. So it's very useful to see the context in your presentation in which this occurred. Sylvia Levin's statement, very important, the need for a new discursive method to look at buildings, and I quote, without relying on narratives of authorship, myths of synthesis, and the easy transubstantiation of material artifacts into images and signs. This is the dot on the I. And Dora Epstein Jones' very clear statement, she says the book as a call to the discipline, and she makes a statement to which I very happily subscribe to. I am of the continuous and constant presence of buildings as the number one of architectural knowledge. So thank you very much.
Shall I? Okay, I noted 3 points, maybe quite short. The first, we'll try to speak about your hypothesis and the content of the book. The second is about the concerns you raise about the state of architectural theory. Mm-hmm. And the third concerns perhaps a more critical approach on the book somehow as a, not for its content, but the material, yes, what it represents somehow. So I completely agree with you, or I think it's a very provocative hypothesis to try to somehow overcome the divide between thinking and making what you're proposing, and to understand architectural theory not as a sub-discipline of other fields, but somehow to propose that architectural theory, through the wide range of things they have to address, which goes from sociological question up to construction question, could be somehow a model for other disciplines and could inform other disciplines like sociology or construction. I think this is a very important, and I think also a goal that we as a faculty inside such a polytechnical school should have as an approach. The second is that somehow the need of this book presents what you have already said, or is an expression also of a high specialization of society, but also of academia, and of architectural history and theory. You traced the divide in the 60s, where suddenly theory becomes an independent field and it's not anymore connected to history. And now people are saying we should do philosophy somehow. So it would be, again, a gap from history, and actual history, which was about theory too, to a divide between the old guys who do annoying things, which is called history, and the other ones who are more fashionable ones who do theory. And now as a theoretic in a that certition are already 50 years old, as we know, and we have to do the next step. And perhaps it would be easier somehow to reflect on what history should do. And try to avoid what we have been fighting, that architecture is not autonomous, and architectural theory, I guess, is not autonomous too. It's linked to something. I'm not sure if it's the building. I could also imagine it's the drawing. It could be other parts of architecture. That's why I see even perhaps a larger approach. And the third is the book itself. And this is probably for me the more critical aspect, is it's the beginning. So somehow you collected things, but at the same time you refuse to take positions because you delegated it to others. And this is, I think, also a problem of our field somehow, that an academic career is as much as about reflection as it is about building networks. And all the people you have shown here, and I was quite surprised to find certain authors, because throughout the last 20 or 30 years, they were never concerned somehow with building. But if there is a fashionable event somehow, they suddenly all are inside the buildings. And so if you take the book as a beginning, I think it's a great book. If you take it as the state of the art, it's extremely problematic about research and about academic research, because it's more about networking than about research. So, it's a negative note. I think two positive at the beginnings, and I think we should also.
I'm dropped in a totally new culture that I am starting to learn by now, the ETR, evening 7 o'clock debates. On my desk Tuesday, seeing students, in the meantime I saw it at noon. I opened it for the first, but then I had to go into conference Skype with my team in Belgium as we were working on a competition. And as I was noticing at that moment already the word building, building, and then I found myself throughout a two-hour Skype, we were constantly talking about the building in Brussels. We have to make good. What does this building say to me? And I was totally confused already, as I first had like a glimpse, 5 minutes, on a book that at first I could not immediately grab. So, I mean, I think the nice thing is, on one hand, I understand that books wants to bridge between, on one hand, the popular meaning of architectural talking, but also wants to bridge towards the practice of the making the building. So in that sense, I'm totally with you. And I got so far that I understood that there is a building, there is the building, there is building. Then all of a sudden it seems architecture, the word, is also not to be confused with building, I know. But I mean, it was cleared out in the book once again. So finally, I had my main question with the book is, of course, that as you bridge, I was looking the entrance of the bridge at this point to me as a practitioner. This sounds a little bit, but I'm just because I'm happy that this would happen. Honestly, it is true. Those we are too far away from each other, and at the same time we read each other. At least it's difficult to read something from our side, I know. Because our texts are always like too conceptual, whatever. But I mean, I understand that, and I have to say then that it was very difficult to me to get in one text very quickly to pick up things. But I will do it. But still, I would ask you, in my opinion, is of my interest would be, how could it come closer? How could we find the real language to talk on this? Very interesting topics, I believe, about the meaning of the building and building and a building and so on and so on. I mean, I'm really interested to be part of that debate, but it's not that I want to be able to get fast in it, but I also should be able to get somehow in it. and I'm interested to do my efforts to it, but it was too short times to get really in it. So it's an issue of being 4 hours ahead of this debate with a book on my knees. But even still then, I believe that even if I had it 4 days able to read it, then I really should have need more than this hour to come closer to each other, I think. I mean, don't feel it as a critic or as an opposite, but I just, as I'm invited here amongst you in the chair of theory and so on, I'm not going to leave this chair now anymore. So, but
yeah, well, you invited me to write a piece that would react to pieces that have been written in the book. First moment I thought, well, I spent a lot of energy in a way being here to move away from the complete fixation on the building that is kind of occupying everybody all day long at the school. Yeah. Yeah. And now you asked me to move back to the building finally. So I thought, well, we probably have different perspective of what's happening. And I think this still, you reflected, of course, when you said there's a difference between European or continental European and American schools, but perhaps also there's a difference within these schools. On the other hand, I find intriguing the idea to merge the practice, merge the materiality, merge the presence of an object and the discussion with it, about it. We're kind of used to discuss about it. How can we talk with the building, for instance? So this, in a way, intrigues me also. Intrigues me also because it's part of a trend to, you know, to talk about material culture, to use objects, materiality, surfaces as sources and subjects to discuss, and try not to refer to existing constructions, ideological, theoretical, discursive sets of values. If you then talk to about building, which probably I am also doing, so for me it was also kind of a challenge to reflect my practice. I don't really think that I found a real answer, but the direction and the input for me makes sense. I'm not sure if it's solved. It's probably, in a way, typical for a younger generation to link production and distribution. I remember that discussions with Niels and Freddy also about the shift of the role artist-curator. That curating is very much about also co-producing art, linking art with architecture, working with networks, this kind of becomes, in many cases, more effective than the production of an artwork as such. And so these roles are shifting. Well, one can be pro or contra, but it's kind of a fact. So I'm observing something comparable in also this chart of heads that you show. Everybody then, of course, first thing, is my head there or not? and then what does it mean if it's there now? Am I already half dead or, something? So this is, it's kind of ambivalent, you've also said that, but still something is intriguing for me about the issue. We had a recent invitation by a chef, a retired chef, of a famous Zurich restaurant, which I hadn't been to, Kaiserseeblaube.
You have incredible contacts.
Yeah,
one month ago, we ate very well with you.
There?
Exactly.
With me?
No, no, But you obviously have a lot of chefs as friends, you know.
So this retired chef, who is now not working there anymore and has time, he set up a dinner with me and three philosophers. And his idea, he had heard a lecture by me and thought that would be interesting to talk to, because I would like to talk about performance. And his idea was, he wanted us to talk the entire dinner only about what was there, what we were eating. Although making philosophy about that, but always returning to what was there. And not, you know, deviating, not entering into theatrical systems. So this, I think this is kind of related to this methodological aim that you're looking for, which is not so clearly defined, but which might be something that attracts us. And one doesn't have to be essentialist. I mean, I'm certainly not among those who say we would just sit there silent and chew, you know, which he also didn't want, because it was a constant talking. But we always had to be careful not to talk about stuff that we, you know, already knew, or it was too much away from that what's happening there. And so it was kind of a collective midterm crit of a changing project on the table, and which reminded me of your intention of the building. Challenge probably for history theory is also to constantly revise one's method, and especially the proximity and the interaction with the subject matter. That's also what makes it exciting and difficult to the same hand to talk with practitioners, because of course I never built a building.
You can talk also about the project.
Okay.
To me, I mean.
No, I don't just talk about cement.
Yeah.
But would that make sense to?
I mean, why is one don't of the we talk about cement? Actually,
could be extremely interesting. No,
I'm asking you. Yeah. Why don't you speak about cement? Because through cement, you could explain a whole. You could explain architecture, but you could also explain all the political and economic system which is behind it. Perfect examples somehow that through a lens of a very material thing you could go into a history which explodes somehow. Mm-hmm. It's a physical artifact, and actually that's what Sarah Nichols is doing, which I think could become very interesting and relevant also, because then it allows you also to see where you can distract logics which seems unavoidable. That cement is that like this because, and when you understand why it is as it is, then you can begin to reflect on it. And I think this is kind of valuable discussion with the practitioners.
In the text on the Truffle House, deals with materiality and this construction process, it's actually in a way that's not so far from your saying now, I think. But I did want to kind of react to both of you. I think some of your questions are actually linked in terms of the authors, how they were selected. There was a very intense research period before reaching out to try to get a combination of hopefully quality, but also diversity of points of view, which is why you see people who normally would not talk about buildings or were forgotten kind of brought back into the project. Didn't happen out of the blue, right? A lot of research before. As a result of that, yes, there is a networking aspect to the project, but hopefully it was a kind of a happy coincidence. Because when you aspire to get a certain level to in terms of the contributors, the result is going to be that you're going to be networking at the same time. Right? So we could speak about how you orchestrate more or less intentionally that networking that's happening in parallel from an American point of view versus a European point of view, and I think that would be an interesting discussion. But definitely that wasn't the first intention, right? For sure not. It was to get quality as much as we could. Right? Then second, I do think that is a position. Right? I it's obviously not an authored book, so it's not going to have the same kind of authorial texture. But at the same time, I think in introduction there is a theoretical proposition as to how the building can be conceived as an object of knowledge, right? Both theoretically and historically, right? In terms of the discursive evolution of architecture over the past 4 or 5 decades, right? So I think that does entail a position in relation to which actually authors were, in a way, forced to react, and actually, I mean, I shared that with everybody, not at the level that is specified in the introduction, but at some more summarized level at the beginning. So I think that's there too. But it worries me a bit when, this is not about you guys, but when I hear that architects might find the book too theoretical, perhaps. That's why I'm always trying to get architects, practitioners, into the conversation to try to see whether there is a way in which we can get at a language more or less shared in which we can have this type of conversation, right? Without either side being disappointed at the kind of language. Right? I was told, for example, at Columbia, Bernard Schumi came up with a question that was impossible to answer, because he said, can you tell us whether there is a new particular kind of language emerging out of this project because of the combination of people in history, given people in practice, vis-a-vis the agenda for the project? Nobody could answer that. I mean, for that, you would have to basically analyze them retrospectively. But I think the answer to that question would basically get at exactly why or how it is that we can elaborate, fabricate a language that's a little bit more common. Now, again, the model for a practitioner in Europe is different, very different from the model for a practitioner in the US. Right? So I'm going to just leave it at that, but that would be an interesting discussion to have as well.
I have a question. Why did you choose buildings to discuss? Because somehow then you put the historian, theoretician in a very defensive position, because he has to speak again about Jan de Waal, or he has to speak again about Sana or about Fujimoto. And I would rather see our position somehow as a theoretician to be able to speak, not to address an author, but to address somehow a question related to building or to architecture, how we call it.
And kind of now it's here, but before it was here, it's kind of wandering through these classrooms. Of course, it's the NATO classrooms, it's North Atlantic Treaty classrooms, but we are part of that, so I cannot totally step out of that. That's the case, but it's open to add new issues that I would say is a quality. It's not it's unclosed. It's not doesn't want to shut down. Doesn't want to define meaning. That's also probably the part of the practice, that you let others speak, or you know, you put words, of course, into their mouths, which is fine. I also like to do that. There's many voices, but they communicate with each other, and others can also share.
Yeah, I think in that sense, what Laurent was saying earlier is very true, that hopefully it's the beginning of a project, actually. It's probably the beginning of another project, in a way. Because it defines, I mean, hopefully it defines a set of game rules, basically, that people are encouraged to embrace and produce knowledge out of it, which is why, I mean, I think intellectually it's interesting to question the premises of the project, right, intellectually, but I think it's more interesting to, as if you were playing soccer or basketball, to in a way accept the rules and then play with them to kind of, you know, keep up with this forward-looking idea for the project, just to produce knowledge, I think. And in that sense, I think another question that Laurent brought up is absolutely crucial. How do you write about a building that has been designed by somebody else, while at the same time trying to bypass the dependency you're going to have on the author or the way he has envisioned his building in a synthetic manner, right? To go back to Sylvia. Well, some people are going to argue that that's actually the single most difficult thing to do on the part of the critic or the person writing about the building, to kind of, in a way, deconstruct the synthetic unity of the building to produce your own basically totality, your own entity of knowledge, as a critic yourself, as opposed to as the architect of the building, right? I mean, that's exactly why, even though what Penelope Dean, for example, says about the Any House does not coincide by any stretch of the imagination with what Su Fujimoto thought about the project when he was designing, still, that is the way in which a critic should engage a building, that is to say, by creating his or her own domain of knowledge, right? In other words, criticism is its own thing, regardless of the unity that is meant by the architect.
It's strange, because it's like you take the building as the object, and immediately you leave it in its existence because you need it to value a certain thinking. And then afterwards comes the question, hey, theory, practice. How far are we from each other? So that's to me a very strange thing someone said it before, that the critical writers or thinkers don't want to do an effort to come back down and talk with the practitioners on it. No, they want to keep it as their object for their order of things, which I believe as an existing which should exist. But then I still ask myself, but why so categorical? Why so? So that's quite some.
I think
you walk away with it. I mean, not that book, but I mean the idea of being critic towards architect. You walk away with it. Why don't you play it back sometimes?
When José talks about because he wanted quality, there are architects who build and write extremely well, and you have to have the courage to engage them and challenge them. But if in Switzerland there is something that we can call suspicion towards theory, certainly on part of many practitioners, there's also this suspicion towards practice on behalf of the theorists. And this is how you're going to bridge the two by actually.
I see the problem of the place. Actually, if one looks back to the big treatise of architecture theory, they never speak about architects. Look for an architect at Alberti, look for an architect at Semper, even Le Corbusier with his 5 points, 2 pages. He doesn't speak about his own buildings, he's speaking about the relation between new materials, new uses, and new aesthetics.
Yeah.
And this is his incredible contribution to architectural theory of the 30s. And there I see, perhaps I don't know where the problem is exactly, but that theoretician always sticks somehow to the practitioner, like the glue on you. You probably have two or three which are always around you. And they are probably independent in the way they contribute to the field. So they contribute somehow to a kind of, I don't know, to a kind of publicity of architecture, but for sure they really suddenly contribute to the field. But even the interesting text in Swiss, now to come back to in Swiss architectural theory, part of the last 30 years, for instance, in Martin Steinmann. He is very interesting. He doesn't speak about the building, but when he speaks about the phenomena, the Gestalt theory, and then he has examples to illustrate it. But he is most interesting, I think, when he doesn't speak about specific persons. And this is probably also part of a kind of strange market in which we historian and theoretician are. And if you don't write about the architect, really difficult situation because they are really not happy about the text we deliver. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Should we continue? I mean, if you have more, what must you say? No, but I'm wondering if we should like open it up to
yes,
the audience now.
Yes.
Or
there was a good Swiss filmmaker who described
why Swiss had so much problem to speak. I'm Swiss, very Swiss, so why you have so much problem to speak. And he said, you know, when a Swiss speaks, he has to reinvent the language to express what he's saying.
No, there are people who have described the project in a way, in exactly the opposite way, to say that by abstracting the building as a title as such, what you do is you erase authorship in a certain way.
Yes, the title is like this, yes,
yeah.
I agree.
So the overall effect of the book is precisely to in a way, dilute the unity of all of these buildings, right, let alone architects, and turn everything into a kind of interplay of different elements, which are exactly what the different authors are picking up on and discussing. So in the case of the truffle house, the concrete and the mold, in the case of the platform plan, right, that's the element. And actually there's a whole section titled element precisely for that reason. So I think there is a little bit of that dilution. At the same time, another way the project has been described to me, which was not at all our intention, but it just happened to be a coincidence, was in terms of a kind of political agenda. Because they say that in this kind of post-truth world, to actually have a more or less fixed anchor to discuss helps combat a little bit the kind of otherwise completely fused environmental discussion. So to have something like, mm-hmm. I think Philip was kind of addressing this earlier, as clear as the building, as a category of knowledge, mm-hmm. helps center mm-hmm. discussion around
yes,
something more. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that was the intention. But,
yeah. So let's continue to speak more informally.
Informally, okay.
In front of
thank you.
Thank you.
So
thank you.
Thank you.